Good morning, and welcome to St. Olav's online service. Today is the fifth Sunday after Easter, commonly known as Rogation Sunday. At the end of our service today, we will be heading outside to bless our gardens in preparation for planting. So I hope you will stay tuned and watch us at the very end of the service head outside and bless the gardens. I'm standing here in our chapel because we are reinstituting our Wednesday Holy Communion services at 11 o'clock. I hope you will consider joining us on Wednesdays at 11 online only at this time. You can find the service on YouTube and you can worship with us at 11 o'clock, but the service will stay up on YouTube and so you can find it anytime after that. You can watch it at your convenience. If you would like to add names to the prayer list, either for the Wednesday service or, as always, for our Sunday service, please email Judy or Alexandra or myself, and we'll make sure those names get added to the list. We will be praying for people out loud at the 11 o'clock Wednesday service, and we encourage you to add names to that list as well. The flowers on the altar this morning are the gift of Linda Rodegard and the late Richard Pakula. To the glory of God and in fond remembrance of Gwen Jones, a beautiful, brave, and gracious soul, thank you for your gift. Our service today is a service of morning prayer, and we begin with the confession on page 4. Our psalms are Psalm 46 and Psalm 63. Our processional hymn is To Thee, Our God, We Fly. But first, a word from our child and youth minister, Martha Riddle.
If you've been following along with our weekly service videos, you'll know that today is the fifth Sunday after Easter. It's also got another name, which is Rogation Sunday. That word rogation comes from the Latin word rogare, which means to ask. That's because during the Rogation days, the Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday before the Feast of the Ascension, we are asking God through solemn prayer for deliverance from present troubles. Now, in today's Junior Church lesson, we're going to take a short break from the Gospel of St. John to look at the Epistle of St. James. St. James has some advice for us on how we can live in a way that is pleasing to God. So today we're going to think about prayer and studying the Bible and how we can put that into action. Make sure you take a look at today's lesson, which is up now on our website.
Thank you.
Lord is nigh unto them that call upon him, to all that call upon him in truth. Dearly beloved brethren, the scripture moveth us in sundry places to acknowledge and confess our manifold sins and wickedness, and that we should not dissemble nor cloak them before the face of Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, but confess them with a humble, lowly, penitent, and obedient heart, to the end that we may obtain forgiveness of the same by his infinite goodness and mercy. Wherefore, I pray and beseech you to accompany me with a pure heart and humble voice unto the throne of the heavenly grace. Almighty and most merciful Father,
we have erred and strayed from thy ways like lost sheep.
We have followed too much the devices and desires of our own hearts. We have offended against thy holy laws. We have left undone those things which we ought to have done, and we have done those things which we ought not to have done. And there is no health in us. But thou, O Lord, have mercy upon us, miserable offenders. Spare thou them, O God, which confess their faults. Restore thou them that are penitent, according to thy promises declared unto mankind, in Christ Jesus our Lord. And grant, O most merciful Father, for his sake, that we may hereafter live a godly, righteous, and sober life, to the glory of thy holy name.
Amen.
Almighty God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who desireth not the death of a sinner, but rather that he may turn from his wickedness and live, hath given power and commandment to his ministers to declare and pronounce to his people, being penitent, the absolution and remission of their sins. He pardoneth and absolveth all them that truly repent and unfeignedly believe his holy gospel. Wherefore, we beseech him to grant us true repentance and his Holy Spirit, that those things may please him which we do at this present, and that the rest of our life hereafter may be pure and holy, so that at the last we may come to his eternal joy, through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive them that trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. O Lord, open thou our lips, and our mouth shall show forth thy praise.
O God, make speed to save us.
O Lord, make haste to help us.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost.
As it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen.
Praise ye the Lord.
The Lord's name be praised.
Alleluia, Christ is risen.
O come, let us worship. Alleluia.
O come, let us sing unto the Lord. Let us heartily rejoice in the strength of our salvation.
Let us come before his presence with thanksgiving and show ourselves glad in him with songs.
For the Lord is our great God and a great King above all gods.
In his hand are all the corners of the earth, and the strength of the hills is his also.
The sea is his, and he made it, and his hands prepared the dry land.
O come, let us worship and fall down, and kneel before the Lord our Maker.
For he is the Lord our God, and we are the people of his pasture, and the sheep of his hand.
Today, O that ye would hear his voice, harden not your heart
tempts us in the provocation, and as in the day of temptation in the wilderness.
When your fathers tempted me, proved me and saw my works.
40 years long was I grieved with that generation and said, it is a people that do err in their hearts, for they have not known my ways.
Unto whom I swear in my wrath, that they should not enter into my rest. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost.
As it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen.
Alleluia, Christ is risen.
O come, let us worship. Alleluia.
God is our hope and strength, a very present help in trouble.
Therefore will we not fear, though the earth be changed, and though the hills be carried into the midst of the sea.
Though the waters thereof rage and swell, and though the mountains shake at the tempest of the same.
The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge.
There is a river, the streams whereof make glad the city of God, the holy place of the tabernacle of the Most High.
God is in the midst of her, therefore shall she not be moved. God shall help her, and that right early.
The nations make much ado, and the kingdoms are moved. But God uttereth his voice, and the earth doth melt away.
The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge.
O come hither, and behold the works of the Lord. What wonders he hath wrought upon the earth.
He maketh wars to cease in all the world. He breaketh the bow and snappeth the spear in sunder, and burneth the chariots in the fire.
Be still then, and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations, and I will be exalted in the earth.
The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost.
As it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen.
O God, thou art my God, early will I seek thee.
My soul thirsteth for thee, my flesh also longeth after thee, in a barren and dry land where no water is.
Thus have I looked upon thee in the sanctuary, that I might behold thy power and glory.
For thy loving kindness is better than the life itself. My lips shall praise thee.
As long as I live, will I magnify thee in this manner. and lift up my hands in thy name.
My soul shall be satisfied, even as it were with marrow and fatness. And my mouth shall praise thee with joyful lips.
When I remember thee upon my bed, I meditate upon thee in the night watches.
Because thou hast been my helper, and under the shadow of thy wings will I rejoice.
My soul cleaveth unto thee. Thy right hand upholdeth me.
These also that seek the hurt of my soul, they shall go into the depths of the earth.
They shall be given over to the power of the sword, that they may be a portion for foxes.
But the king shall rejoice in God. All they that swear by him shall be glad. For the mouth of them that speak lies shall be stopped.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost.
As it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen.
The first lesson is written in the general epistle of James, the first chapter, beginning at the 22nd verse. Be ye doers of the word, and not hearers only, deceiving your own selves. For if any be a hearer of the word, and not a doer, he is like unto a man beholding his natural face in a glass. For he beholdeth himself, and goeth his way, and straightway forgetteth what manner of man he was. But whoso looketh into the perfect law of liberty, and continueth therein, he be not a forgetful hearer, but a doer of the work, this man shall be blessed in his deed. If many man among you seem to be religious, and bridleth not his tongue, but deceiveth his own heart, this man's religion is vain. Pure religion and undefiled before God and the Father is this, to visit the fatherless and widows in their affliction, and to keep himself unspotted from the world. Here ends the first lesson.
We praise thee, O God. We acknowledge thee to be the Lord.
All the earth doth worship thee, the Father everlasting.
To thee all angels cry aloud, the heavens and all the powers therein.
To thee cherubim and seraphim continually do cry,
Holy, 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 Lord God of hosts. Heaven and earth are full of the majesty of thy glory.
The glorious company of the apostles praise thee. The goodly fellowship of the prophets praise thee.
The noble army of martyrs praise thee. The holy church throughout all the world doth acknowledge thee.
The Father of an infinite majesty,
thine honorable, true, and only Son. Also the Holy Ghost, the Comforter.
Thou art the King of glory, O Christ. Thou art the everlasting Son of the Father.
When thou tookest upon thee to deliver man, thou didst not abhor the virgin's womb.
When thou hadst overcome the sharpness of death, didst open the kingdom of heaven to all believers.
Thou sittest at the right hand of God, in the glory of the Father.
We believe that thou shalt come to be our judge.
We therefore pray thee, help thy servants, whom thou hast redeemed with thy precious blood.
Make them to be numbered with thy saints in glory everlasting.
The second lesson is written in the Gospel according to St. John, the 16th chapter, beginning at the 23rd verse. Jesus said unto his disciples, "Verily, verily, I say unto you, whatsoever ye shall ask the Father in my name, he will give it you. Hitherto have ye asked nothing in my name. Ask, and ye shall receive, that your joy may be full. These things have I spoken unto you in parables. The time cometh when I shall no more speak unto you in parables, but I shall show you plainly of the Father. At that day ye shall ask in my name, and I say not unto you, that I will pray the Father for you. For the Father himself loveth you, because ye have loved me, and have believed that I came out from God. I came forth from the Father, and am come into the world. Again I leave the world, and go to the Father." His disciples said unto him, "Lo, now speakest thou plainly, and speakest no parable. Now are we sure that thou knowest all things, and needest not that any man should ask thee. By this we believe that thou camest forth from God." Jesus answered them, "Do ye now believe? Behold, the hour cometh, yea, is now come, that ye shall be scattered every man to his own, and shall leave me alone. And yet I am not alone, because the Father is with me. These things have I spoken unto you, that in me ye might have peace. In the world ye shall have tribulations, but be of good cheer. I have overcome the world." Here endeth the lesson.
Blessed be the Lord God of Israel, for he hath visited and redeemed his people,
and hath raised up a mighty salvation for us in the house of his servant David,
as he spake by the mouth of his holy prophets, which have been since the world began,
that we should be saved from our enemies and from the hands of all that hate us,
to perform the mercy promised to our forefathers, and to remember his holy covenant,
to perform the oath which he sware to our forefather Abraham, that he would grant us,
that we, being delivered out of the hands of our enemies, might serve him without fear,
in holiness and righteousness before him, all the days of our life.
And thou, child, shalt be called the prophet of the highest, for thou shalt go before the face of the Lord to prepare his ways,
to give knowledge of salvation unto his people, for the remission of their sins,
through the tender mercy of our God, whereby the day spring from on high hath visited us,
to give light to them that sit in darkness and in the shadow of death, and to guide our feet into the way of peace.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost.
As it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven, and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
One thinks that time hardly moves, or doesn't move at all. He has the impression that the day is 50 hours long. It causes a person to look constantly to see how much time has passed, or if anything is happening outside the window. It instills in him a loathing for the place where he is, for his work, and causes him to think that goodwill is a thing of the past. It leads him to long for other places, where things would be easier. He longs for his earlier life, and his current, less pleasant life stretches out before him in his imagination. If you've been reading or watching the news lately, you may have noticed a recent focus on the psychological phenomenon known as languishing. It's not a particularly new term, but it's been getting some media attention lately because of where we find ourselves. More than a year into a global pandemic, that is keeping many of us isolated and keeping most of us away from the things that usually offer joy and excitement. This phenomenon known as languishing can be described as a sort of mental and emotional doldrums. It's not quite depression or burnout. These are serious conditions requiring medical intervention. But it's something more common and less severe. Languishing is more akin to a prolonged boredom and lack of enthusiasm, even a decreased ability to focus. And many of these news articles about languishing are saying that it's the prevailing mental state of 2021, now that we've moved past the sense of urgency we collectively felt when the pandemic first hit. But the more I hear about languishing, the more I can't help but notice how much it sounds like that condition called acedia by the early church. The paragraph I read at the beginning, although it picks up the characteristics of languishing, is in fact a 4th century description of acedia by the desert monk and theologian Evagrius. I paraphrased it only slightly to obscure the fact that Evagrius is specifically writing about monks living in mud brick cells. Acedia is sometimes known to us by the English word sloth. But the word sloth has unfortunately come to be misunderstood. In popular terms, sloth is usually thought to be something akin to laziness, thought to be a blameworthy choice. But the early church understood acedia to be an affliction. And it's an affliction that especially troubled those men and women who chose a life of isolation and routine. As soon as Christians began seeking out lives of solitude for the purposes of prayer, acedia was recognized as the midday illness of Psalm 91, the sickness that destroyeth in the noonday. It's called the noonday demon by some early Christian writers because of its particular intensity in the middle of a desert day. Acedia somehow manages to encompass both a lack of energy for one's daily activities and a type of restlessness, an urge to try shaking off the tedium by trying something new, then another something new, then another. For us, right now, we are not in isolation by choice, like the desert mothers and fathers were in the first few centuries of the church. And so the condition doesn't exactly manifest as a temptation like it did for them. Part of the struggle for these early ascetics was overcoming the desire for something and someplace else, and to abandon the life of prayer they had previously and freely chosen. But the way acedia erodes our contentment is, I suspect, largely the same. And for many of us, as it did for them, it hinders our ability to delight in prayer. This attack on a person's ability to pray was the most devastating effect of acedia for the desert monks. The despondent monk is dilatory in prayer, writes Evagrius, and at times he does not speak the words of prayer at all. The resilience of his soul has gone slack. And if this decreased delight in prayer, perhaps even a decreased ability to make ourselves pray, is true for us now as well, perhaps today, the day known as Rogation Sunday, with its special focus on prayer, is a day to think about recovering our practice. These same men and women who walked the path of despondency before us also left guideposts for recovery, even from that state. The desert fathers and mothers turned to the words of Psalms that seemed to echo their affliction, themselves reaching for comfort in even more ancient writings. Psalms 42 and 43 contain a familiar lament. Why art thou so full of heaviness, O my soul? And why art thou so disquieted within me? Where no other prayer is possible, the ancient wisdom tells us to offer one that is short and focused. And it tells us that even our sorrow in longing for a different condition is in itself a sort of prayer. Because of what prayer is, even a poorly understood yearning offered to God as something we hope he can redeem, makes space in us for the Spirit to utter those sighs too deep for words that the Apostle tells us about. This is because the Spirit that dwells in us draws us into the life of God's beloved Son. When Jesus speaks to the disciples about their future membership in the church, he tells them that then they will begin to pray in his name. They will no longer ask him so that he can ask the Father on their behalf, but their own prayers will become one with his. They will pray in his name in the sense that they will pray as one with him. This is the work of the Spirit in prayer. And it reflects the whole movement of our lives as Christians, as a people being sanctified, made one with Christ in a mystical union, and growing into that in the midst of our lives. A people who are learning gradually to see ourselves as part of him, to act as part of him, to live and work and pray as part of him. The wonderful mystery of Christian prayer is that it isn't ours. But the decision to pray is an act by which we can choose to take part in the one perfect and eternal prayer of Christ. Christian prayer is more an identity than it is an activity. It's a way that we live into who we are in Christ, as parts of him, adding our joys and sorrows and desires to his prayer. From the moment we were joined with him, every Christian, since the very first day of the church, has been adding their voice to that one great prayer that finds perfection in Christ. All of this remains true in us now, no matter our emotional state, even in those times when prayer may feel impossible. In fact, those prayers that we offer, knowing how incapable we are, may be the ones that come closest to the truth. They don't belong to us. We don't know how to pray as we should. But our desire to draw closer to God is the life of God stirring within us. And he will grant us this desire. Where it exists, he has already begun.
As we pray this morning, let us pray for the church. Let us pray particularly today for the Anglican Church of Kenya, and within our own diocese for the Oshawa Deanery. And let us pray for the work of the Primates World Relief and Development Fund, especially as they continue to address the ongoing needs and concerns of COVID-19. Let us pray for this parish, for our South Sudanese brothers and sisters, for Kathy Langston's Hosanna Children's Mission to Romania, for the Second Century Mission Fund, and for Hunger Patrol. Let us pray for the nations of the world, that peace may be known. Let us pray for an end to all forms of inequity, brutality, violence, and abuses of power. Let us pray for the sick, especially those suffering from COVID-19. And let us pray also for Doris, Ellen, Diana, Adam, Kathy, Max, Bernadette, Katarina, and Heather. Let us pray for those in other forms of need, for the recently bereaved, for the unemployed, and for those in any form of anxiety or distress, especially Philip, Bonnie and her family, Graydon and his family, Linda and family, Dina Kritzer. And finally, let us remember before God those of our brethren who have departed this life and are at rest, especially Tim Gray, Bishop Michael Bedford Jones, Richard Pakula, and on his year's mind, Tony Bridges, who died on the 11th of May, 2014. Rest eternal grant unto them, O Lord.
And let light perpetual shine upon them.
May they rest in peace and rise with Christ in glory.
Amen.
Let us pray.
O God, the Father, creator of heaven and earth, have mercy upon us.
O God, the Father, creator of heaven and earth, have mercy upon us.
O God, the Son, redeemer of the world, have mercy upon us.
O God, the Son, redeemer of the world, have mercy upon us.
O God, the Holy Ghost, sanctifier of the faithful, have mercy upon us.
O God, the Holy Ghost, sanctifier of the faithful, have mercy upon us.
O Holy, Blessed, and Glorious Trinity, three persons and one God, have mercy upon us.
O Holy, Blessed, and Glorious Trinity, three persons and one God, have mercy upon us.
Remember not, Lord, our offenses, nor the offenses of our forefathers. Spare us, good Lord, spare thy people, whom thou hast redeemed with thy most precious blood.
Spare us, good Lord,
from all evil and mischief, from sin, from the crafts and assaults of the devil, from thy wrath and from everlasting condemnation.
Good Lord, deliver us
from all blindness of heart, from pride, vainglory, and hypocrisy, from envy, hatred, and malice, and all uncharitableness.
Good Lord, deliver us
from all uncleanness in thought, word, and deed, and from all the deceits of the world, the flesh, and the devil.
Good Lord, deliver us
from lightning and tempest, from earthquake, fire, and flood, from plague, pestilence, and famine, from battle and murder, and from sudden death.
Good Lord, deliver us
from all sedition, conspiracy, and rebellion, from all false doctrine, heresy, and schism, from hardness of heart and contempt of thy word and commandment.
Good Lord, deliver us
by the mystery of thy holy incarnation, by thy holy nativity, by thy baptism, fasting, and temptation.
Good Lord, deliver us
by thine agony and bloody sweat, by thy cross and passion, by thy precious death and burial.
Good Lord, deliver us
by thy glorious resurrection and ascension, by thy sending of the Holy Spirit, by thy heavenly intercession, and by thy coming again in glory.
Good Lord, deliver us.
In all times of tribulation, in all times of prosperity, in the hour of death, and in the day of judgment.
Good Lord, deliver us.
We sinners do beseech thee to hear us, O Lord God, and that it may please thee to rule and govern thy holy church universal in the right way.
We beseech thee, good Lord,
to keep and strengthen in the true worshipping of thee, in holiness of life, and in devotion to our people, thy servant Elizabeth, our most gracious queen and governor.
We beseech thee, good Lord,
to be her defender and keeper, giving her the victory over all her enemies.
We beseech thee, good Lord,
to bless and preserve Charles, the Prince of Wales, and Camilla, the Duchess of Cornwall, Prince William and Catherine, the Duke and Duchess of Cambridge, Prince George, Princess Charlotte, and Prince Louis, and all the royal family.
We beseech thee, good Lord,
to give to all bishops, priests, and deacons true knowledge and understanding of thy word, and that both by their preaching and living they may set it forth and show it accordingly.
We beseech thee, good Lord,
to send forth laborers into thy harvest, to prosper their work by thy Holy Spirit, to make thy saving health known unto all nations, and to hasten thy kingdom.
We beseech thee, good Lord,
to bless the people of our country and the commonwealth, and to endue those set in authority with grace, wisdom, and understanding.
We beseech thee, good Lord,
to bless and guide the judges and magistrates, giving them grace to execute justice and to maintain truth.
We beseech thee, good Lord,
to bless and keep the Queen's forces by sea and land and air, and to shield them in all dangers and adversities.
We beseech thee, good Lord,
to give to all nations unity, peace, and concord, that they may serve thee without fear.
We beseech thee, good Lord,
to bless and protect all who serve mankind by their labor and learning.
We beseech thee, good Lord,
to preserve all that travel, all women laboring of child, all sick persons and young children, and to show thy pity upon all prisoners and captives.
We beseech thee, good Lord,
to defend and provide for all widows and orphans, and all who are desolate and oppressed.
We beseech thee, good Lord,
to bless and keep all thy people.
We beseech thee, good Lord,
to give to all thy people increase of grace, to hear meekly thy word, and to receive it with pure affection, and to bring forth the fruit of the Spirit.
We beseech thee, good Lord,
to bring into the way of truth all who have erred and are deceived.
We beseech thee, good Lord,
to strengthen such as do stand, to encourage the faint-hearted, to raise up those who fall, and finally to beat down Satan under our feet.
We beseech thee, good Lord,
to succor, help, and comfort all that are in danger, necessity, and tribulation.
We beseech thee, good Lord,
to have mercy upon all men.
We beseech thee, good Lord,
to give and preserve to our use the kindly fruits of the earth, so that in due time we may enjoy them.
We beseech thee, good Lord,
to forgive our enemies, persecutors, and slanderers, and to turn their hearts.
We beseech thee, good Lord,
to give us true repentance, to forgive us all our sins, negligences, and ignorances, and to endue us with the grace of thy Holy Spirit, to amend our lives according to thy holy word.
We beseech thee, good Lord.
Son of God, we beseech thee to hear us.
Son of God, we beseech thee to hear us.
O Lamb of God, that takest away the sin of the world,
have mercy upon us.
O Lamb of God, that takest away the sin of the world,
grant us thy peace.
O Christ, hear us.
O Christ, hear us.
Lord, have mercy upon us.
Christ, have mercy upon us.
Lord, have mercy upon us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive them that trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Amen. O Lord, from whom all good things do come, grant to us thy humble servants, that by thy holy inspiration we may think those things that be good, and by thy merciful guiding may perform the same. Through our Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Almighty God, who has given us grace at this time with one accord to make our common supplications unto thee, and dost promise that when two or three are gathered together in thy name, thou wilt grant their requests. Fulfill now, O Lord, the desires and petitions of thy servants, as may be most expedient for them, granting us in this world knowledge of thy truth, and in the world to come, life everlasting.
Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Ghost be with us all evermore.
Amen.
O give thanks unto the Lord, for he is gracious.
Because his mercy endureth forever.
Let us pray. Almighty and merciful God, from whom cometh every good and perfect gift, bless, we beseech thee, the labors of thy people, and cause the earth to bring forth her fruits abundantly in their season, that we may with grateful hearts give thanks to thee for the same, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Rejoice in the Lord, O ye righteous, for it becometh well the just to be thankful.
Praise the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits.
Let us pray. O gracious Father, who openest thy hand and fillest all things living with plenteousness, we beseech thee to hear our supplications, to renew the face of the earth, and to multiply the harvests of the world, that our land may yield her increase, and thy people may give thanks to thy name. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
May God the Father, maker of heaven and earth, and God the Son, through whom all things were created, and God the Holy Spirit, who hovered over the face of the deep, pour his blessing upon this garden and all things that he hath made, and may it produce his gifts in due season.
Amen.
Amen.